Hey, Life Groups. Good to see that you're meeting this week and meeting like the Acts Church did in 242, where they are meeting, breaking bread, praying for each other, having a great fellowship time, but also getting into the Apostles' Doctrine, which is the Word of God. So we're just going to be doing that. This evening, we're going to be getting into Psalm 73, and we're going to read it in its entirety, verses 1 through 28 in the New Living Translation. And I want you guys to be thinking about the cycle that we get into, and social media has really helped with this, but we went through it even before then, looking at what other people have based upon how close that we feel they're walking with the Lord. So we start with our truth, then we get into trouble because we look around and get tripped up, then comes the trespass. Hopefully soon thereafter comes the turning point, and then God sets us back into the truth. But then once we're back into the truth, we have a task at hand. And so let's start reading in verse 1. It is a psalm of Asaph. Truly God is good to Israel, to those whose hearts are pure. But as for me, I almost lost my footing. My feet were slipping and I was almost gone. For I envied the proud when I saw them prosper despite their wickedness. They seem to live such painless lives. Their bodies are so healthy and strong. And they don't have troubles like other people. They're not plagued with problems like everybody else. They wear pride like a jeweled necklace and clothe themselves with cruelty. These fat cats have everything their hearts could ever wish for. They scoff and speak only evil. In their pride, they seek to crush others. They boast against the very heavens, and their words strut throughout the earth. And so the people are dismayed and confused, drinking in all their words. What does God know? They ask. Does the Most High even know what's happening? Look at these wicked people, enjoying a life of ease while their riches multiply. Did I keep my heart pure for nothing? Did I keep myself innocent for no reason? I get nothing but trouble all day long. Every morning brings me pain. If I had really spoken this way to others, I would have been a traitor to your people. So I tried to understand why the wicked prosper. But what a difficult task it is. Then I went into your sanctuary, O God, and I finally understood the destiny of the wicked. Truly, you put them on a slippery path and send them sliding over the cliff to destruction. In an instant, they are destroyed, completely swept away by terrors. When you arise, O Lord, you will laugh at their silly ideas, as a person laughs at dreams in the morning. Then I realized that my heart was bitter, and I was all torn up inside. I was so foolish and ignorant. I must have seemed like a senseless animal to you. Yet I still belong to you. You hold my right hand. You guide me with your counsel, leading me to a glorious destiny. Whom have I in heaven but you? I desire you more than anything on earth. My health may fail and my spirit may grow weak, but God remains the strength of my heart. He is mine forever. Those who desert him will perish, for you destroy those who abandon you. But as for me, how good it is to be near God. I have made the Sovereign Lord my shelter, and I will tell everyone about the wonderful things you do. So guys, as we see this cycle, you see him pronounce the truth in the very beginning. Verse 1, truly God is good to Israel, to those whose hearts are pure. And we know that as members of the church body, as members of his family, he is good. And if you've traveled with the Lord for any length of time, you've seen him come through over and over again. So we know the truth. God is good. But as for me, he says in verse 2, I almost lost my footing. My feet were slipping and I was almost gone. The Bible says that the word is a lamp unto our feet. And if we have that out in front of us, it's easy to see our path in life and where to step. But as soon as we get our eyes off of the lamp and start looking around at other people and what they have going for them, despite how wicked they are or how far they've fallen, it can turn into a trespass. And that in verse 3, it says, I envied the proud when I saw them prosper despite their wickedness. And so this is where our trespass comes in. Again, later on in this, in the verses, he'll go through why that is. And he discovers that it's actually the wickedness or the bitterness in our own hearts that we have to fix. It's not their problem, it's ours. But in Exodus 20, verse 17, here is the trespass. You must not covet your neighbor's house. You must not covet your neighbor's wife, male or female servant, ox or donkey, or anything else that belongs to your neighbor. So the trespass is here that we are envying the proud when we saw them prosper despite their wickedness. So we've transgressed the law now. Again, it's our issue. The issue every time is an issue of the heart. And so the turning point, hopefully, like I said earlier, comes quickly, is in verse 17, when he says, "Then I went into your sanctuary, O God, and I finally understood the destiny of the wicked. I realized that my heart was bitter and I was all torn up inside. And then realizing I was so foolish and ignorant, I must have seemed like a senseless animal to you. Trust God, for he is good." We don't understand everything. We can see how we'd know that people, we know them in real life and we see their Instagram feed and we think, how come they're all hooked up with the best clothes and health and wealth and prosperity? We know the lives that they live and they're not close to God. So that doesn't seem fair. Well, we realize as we walk with the Lord that that doesn't matter if it's fair or not, because if we ask for what's fair, we're all in a big heap of trouble. So the truth that we come back to at the end of that, realizing that it's a heart issue, is in verse 23, "Yet I still belong to you, you hold my right hand. You guide me with your counsel, leading me to a glorious destiny." And verse 25 is the absolute truth that we need to rest on. Who have I in heaven but you? I desire you more than anything on earth. My health may fail and my spirit may grow weak, but God remains the strength of my heart and he is mine forever. He says, I desire you more than anything on earth. And that, in our heart of hearts, the truth of truths, it's true. We want God. We want to walk with him more than we want anything on earth. But as we walk through this life on this path and we get so focused on other people and what they have, we can lose sight of that and think that we want what those other people have. And so, as for me, how good it is to be near God. And he finishes with, "I have made the sovereign Lord my shelter, and I will tell everyone about the wonderful things you do." So guys, as you think through these verses, think about the truth that we really want God over everything else. And then when we come back to that truth, we want others to have God as well. And we know that's the best thing for them over the things of this life, health, wealth, and prosperity. So as we go through this, at the end of the day, we have a mission after we understand the truth, and that is to tell everyone about the wonderful things that God has done for us. So, life groups, why don't you discuss this week a couple things that God has done in your life for you. Give him praise, give him honor, but really lift him high by discussing and explaining to other people how God has come through in your life, and everything else fades away into the distance in that moment. So we're praying for you down here. We're looking forward to seeing you this next weekend. We'll see you soon.